like to call to order the Rockingham County Board of Elections meeting, the regular meeting, February 15th, 2022, 10 o'clock a.m. in the Rockingham County Governmental Center, 371 North Carolina 65, Reesville, North Carolina. I'd like to welcome those of you who have come to visit with us this morning, and for those of you who are watching via satellite, or we also welcome you in the comfort of your home or your office. Will you please stand as we say the Pledge of Allegiance and remain standing for the invocation by Pastor Nathan DeFalco. The Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Member Schoolfield.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands,
one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Appreciate the privilege and the honor to pray for the meeting this morning and for the fine people of our county. If you would indulge me, the reading from Psalm 37 says, "The steps of a man are established by the Lord. When he delights in his way, though he fall, he shall not be cast headlong, for the Lord upholds his hand. I have been young and now I am old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken or his children begging for bread. He is ever lending generously, and his children become a blessing." Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity to represent you here in this county, to give glory to you in our thoughts and our actions. And we ask, Lord, that as decisions are being made today, that they will be made with certainty, but with the understanding that, yes, we make our plans, but you order our steps. And we ask, Lord, that the actions that are done today and the people that are affected by it will keep the evil elements out of our county, that will keep those destructive elements that will seek to bring disunity and disharmony to our communities, and will instead trade that disunity for unity found in you. As we make wise choices, wise decisions, and put the right people in place that you want in place to lead every single person that lives near us. And as the scripture says, Lord, that if we do righteously in your eyes, that we will never go hungry, that we will never be found begging, and that our children will call us blessed. And we ask that for this morning, and we pray for the wisdom and guidance of the decisions that need to be made today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And again, we thank Pastor Nathan DeFalco. I hope I have pronounced your name correctly. From New Life Baptist Church, Madison, North Carolina. I'd like to entertain a motion for the approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we approve the agenda. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposes, nay. You have approved the agenda. Moving on to number five, approval of the board minutes. I'd like to entertain a motion.
I so move.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we approve the minutes for January 25th, 2022, regular meeting minutes. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All not in favor, say aye. Aye. You have approved the minutes. At this time, I need to open the floor for public comments, and our director will read a statement.
The public comment period shall be for the purpose of allowing members of the public
to present any matter pertaining to election business or items on the Board of Elections agenda. Remarks shall be addressed directly to the Board of Elections and not to staff, the audience, or media. The chair shall open the public comment period. Any speaker who wishes to speak shall approach the podium and not speak from his or her seat. Each speaker shall clearly state his or her name and physical address when he or she approaches the podium and shall be allotted 3 minutes.
Thank you. We have two who have signed up for public comment, and we also received an email. The board members, I don't know if you got a chance to read it this morning, but if it is okay with you, we can have Paula to read it at the end of the people who have signed up. So the first person on our sign up is Ann Brady.
Good morning. I'm Ann Brady. I live at 3190 NC65 Reidsville. Thank you for the opportunity to express my concerns. First, I'm against the General Assembly's move that took away our local option for opening remote sites. To open three remote sites will cost over $40,000, or approximately $40 per early remote voter based on the 2018 election numbers. 2014 and 2018 had remotes open only 5 days, while Wentworth was open the whole time. That makes a whole lot more sense. Three remotes now need to be open for a total of 13 days and for longer hours, or about three times as many hours. Thus, we need to advocate at the state level to change what the General Assembly passed, namely that local option on opening remote sites has been removed. My second concern is that I believe, despite the cost, that it is important to make voting as accessible to our citizens as possible. Leaving remote sites closed for the 2022 primary sets a very bad precedent, in my opinion. We already have very low turnout in off-year primaries. 2018 had a quarter-cent referendum on the ballot, as well as primaries for both local candidates for both parties. And yet, for each 100 voters, registered voters, in Rockingham County, approximately 16 voted at all. Of those 16, about 12 voted on Election Day, 2 voted in Wentworth, and less than 2 at remote sites. This year has no referendi, and at this point, only Republicans have any local candidate choices for the primary. So I would predict an even lower turnout. We don't need to add to this situation less poll access. We don't need to set a bad precedent by having less than all three remote sites available to our voters. We need to do all we can to encourage all of our citizens to vote. I hope the Board of Commissioners will allocate the needed funds. The memo from Lance just plays the blame game. We need the commissioners to act to make voting accessible to our citizens. Thank you, Board of Elections and Director, for working together to make voting as accessible as possible. Please vote for all three sites, remote sites, to be open. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ann Brady. Next person up is Wally White.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Wally White from 314 Von Ruck Road in Eden. And I first and mainly just want to thank you all for how well you all have been working together. It's a pleasure to see after the previous makeups that we had been seeing in recent times. So thank you all for the work you're doing together. And I think, as Anne was saying, I think that the general public doesn't realize that the days and hours of operations are set by the General Assembly and not by you all, and that that large fund of $41,000 or whatever exactly it is is going, if it's done, it's going into the pockets of our local citizens to work those polls. And that it's not the days and the hours that you would necessarily even choose. It's if you give voter accessibility, you're forced to spend that money. And I think it's important for them to know that that's not in your hands, that that's been forced on you by the General Assembly. And I hope that people can hear that and know that. And I know that the people that were involved in that last press release from the county do know that and chose not to say it. And I find that insulting. So thank you all for what you're doing, and I hope that we can find a way to make as much voter accessibility as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Wally White. Paula, if you would read the email, and I'm sure you're going to say that person's name.
Okay, this email is from Chris Senton, S-H-E-N-T-O-N, local fellow, voting rights group, Southern Coalition for Social Justice, out of Durham, North Carolina. This is, dear Director Seamster and Rockingham County Board of Elections, please find below public comment concerning Agenda Item 7, Primary One-Stop Implementation Plan for the February 15, 2022 meeting of the board. Number one, option one, with only one early voting site at the CBOE office, would remove both the most popular overall one-stop site in 2020, Madison Library, where 27.91% of early votes were cast in 2020, and the one-stop site preferred by black voters in 2020, Salvation Army Community Center in Reidsville, where 45% of all black early voters cast their ballots. Option one would also leave voters in western Rockingham County with significant travel time to vote early, in some cases over 15 miles, and reliant on limited public transportation options if they are without a car. Number two, we urge you to adopt option five, which provides for all four early voting sites in the parts of the county where Rockingham voters are accustomed to voting early. Number three, the Board of County Commissioners has a legal obligation to fund elections in Rockingham County. The State Board of Elections has said that lack of funds is not a sufficient reason to not have an early voting site. The budgetary reallocations proposed by the County Commissioners are not acceptable. Voters should not bear the burden of reallocating staff salaries, voting supplies, and staff training just to have early voting available. Number four, even temporary changes in election procedures have a long-lasting effect on voter behavior. Even if a change in the number of early voting sites available was made only for the 2022 primary, experience has shown that uncertainty about where and how to vote will persist long after those changes. Academic research has verified that voters already know a change in one election will have a ripple effect. Voters should be spared from budgetary whiplash. Number five, the State Board of Elections can only consider alternative plans if there is a non-unanimous vote pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 163-227.6A. If the Board of Elections disagrees with the Board of County Commissioners and would like to pursue a plan for early voting in the primary that provides full access to Rockingham voters, yet does not want to adopt option five without having the funds already allocated, you should not unanimously adopt option one. Instead, any vote approving option one should not be unanimous, and at least one motion should be offered and seconded to adopt option five. This should be done on the record and reflected in the meeting minutes. This will give the State Board the option to consider both plans and to work with you to come to a solution that is best for the Rockingham County voters. If you have any questions or concerns, please feel free to reach out to either myself or my colleague, Caitlin Kaiser. We are available at your convenience. Thank you for all your work that you do for the voters in Rockingham County.
Thank you, Paula, for reading the email. So, board members, we come to the point number 7, 2022 primary one-stop implementation plan. And I just need to say a couple of things before we move on to number 7. The Board of Elections entertained a call meeting on February 9th. You already know that, but this is for the public. One item on the agenda was to review suggested line items by County Manager Lance Meltzer from the 21-22 appropriated budget to meet the needs to open 4 sites for one step. That's our budget. After reviewing those line items suggested, we were not able to find $41,000 to open the 4 sites. Therefore, we still do not have the amount of money needed to change our previously voted one-stop plan. Our plan needs to be sent to the State Board of Elections on February 18th. Board members, is there any discussion or questions you have for the county manager who has asked to come in and explain why he sent things? So I'm leaving it up to you as to whether we move on with our vote or if we have him come in and you may have some questions for him. Discussion, please.
Madam Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
I have recently been advised by a county commissioner who advised me that he had confirmed this with a county commissioner vote, that we should go ahead and spend the money to implement all the voting sites that we normally have in the one-stop program, and that if we come up short at a later time, they will give us the money.
Any more discussion? So, do we call Mr. Meltzer in, or should we move forward?
Do you have any suggestions as to where that money was going to come from? We've looked at our budget.
We have looked at our budget, but there was no explanation in his memo to Paula, and she wasn't sure of what he wanted to explain to us.
I was speaking of the county commissioner that had confirmed the vote, that he had had a vote. Is he willing to let you discuss who that was?
I didn't ask that question. And there was no explanation of how this came about.
Why? Because we've had several opportunities for the county commissioners to take this action. So I'm concerned about someone making that commitment without knowing that the county committee, because what choice do we have if we vote to go all 4 sites and we don't have the money? What are our options?
I wasn't given any detailed information other than that statement.
And we don't have a written commitment. This day and time, you need a written commitment saying that you did communicate with one of the members of the Board of Elections to say that you would do this or that. And I don't feel this chair to move forward with hearsay. When you do have a chair you can communicate with, and you do have our director, that you could have given more explicit explanation on your email that comes at the 11th hour yesterday around 4:30. So, board members, what is your pleasure if we have no more discussion?
Madam Chair, I'd like to be recognized.
Yes, sir.
I spent the better part of yesterday evening going through that part of the book, and this is the election laws. Number one, we don't have the right to appropriate funds as the County Board of Elections. If we advise that even just one of us votes against the plan that would say we're going to go with one stop, then it goes to the State Board of Elections. The State Board of Elections and the county are the only two entities involved in this process beyond our decision on what to do. I think it's incumbent upon us to provide the opportunity for people to vote in Rockingham County to the extent that they have in the past and where they have voted in the past. I think that we need to speak to that from that standpoint and look at it. And if you read this, if just one of us says no, and I plan to vote against the plan that we have previously adopted, then it goes to the state board, and the state board has interaction within the county to make the funds available for the project to be carried out. And I think if we deny just one person the right to vote, we're wrong.
Any more discussion? Do I have a motion?
Is this, Madam Chairman, is this the appropriate time to ask Mr. Metzler to come in? And
if you would like to ask him to come in and ask questions, then Paula, if you would ask him to come in. I think he made himself available, and Paul and Justin as well. So this is our opportunity to hear from them. County Manager, I think some of us have a couple of questions. We already understand what you've asked us to do.
Yes, ma'am.
But I think we need some questions need to be asked by one or two of the members.
Sure.
Where's yours? Did you want to ask a question?
Mr. Metzler, we received your information about where we could get some extra funding from our current budget, but I was advised yesterday by one of the county commissioners for us to go ahead and spend the money that we have, and if at a later time we had a budget shortfall, then they would give us the money that we would need to perform our duties. Are you aware of that?
Yes, ma'am. So just to make clarification, so again, Paul and I had talked, and we've looked at the budget, and there might be some discrepancies in what we found that you could use versus what she thinks you can use. But I feel like that I can support you all is if you have a shortfall, you start seeing a shortfall in advance of the end of the fiscal year, then I could support going with Paula back to my Board of Commissioners requesting additional funds if needed. Does that answer the question?
Answers my question.
Okay.
Does that have the backing of the county commissioners?
Again, I can't answer for the board, but I've talked to a few of them, and I feel that I could go back to them and seek that approval.
Okay.
I feel comfortable with making that recommendation.
Okay.
Okay, my question is, we have, when we make a one-stop decision, we send this into the state board by the 18th.
Yes, ma'am.
What is your timeline in going to the board, and what is their timeline in getting back to us?
Well, no, I think that the ask is that you all look within your budget if you're going to fund, you know, one, two, three, or four different early voting sites. If you decide to fund whatever, is that the very end of the year, if you start running low on funds to operate, then we'll go back to the board and request additional funds at that time.
Any other?
So basically what you're saying is that we don't have to take money from other areas. We can
find it within your own budget, you know, and that would come to the board for their approval to transfer the funds. That's just a process. And then if you're at the, you know, in April or May, if you start seeing you're running short for some reason, then I will go back to the board, or we'll go back to the board collectively and request additional funding.
Okay, here's one other notation I would like to make. We did look within our budget, and we were only able to get $28,000 that we were willing to give up.
Okay.
Tell us what to do about that.
Okay, well, I could point out one, two, three, four, five, six different line items that I could work with your staff into making sure that the $41,000 is found within your budget. And again, if you fall short at the end of the year, fiscal year, and you need additional funds to operate, I'll work with our board to make sure that's taken care of.
I'm not an expert on appropriations law, but I understood generally when the legislature creates a line item in a budget, then funds must be expended for the purpose in that line item. Is that?
In county government, you can move those around as long as the board approves it.
Which board?
Board of Commissioners.
Change we would propose to make in our budget to find this $41,000 would have to go to the commissioners first and get their approval to move,
yes,
from one line item to another.
Yes.
Okay.
Correct me if I'm wrong.
Okay.
How long does that usually take?
We could put it on the next board meeting.
Which is the 28th?
Yeah, the 21st.
Board members, I'd like to entertain a motion.
I would just like to comment on Mr. Metzler's statements. You know, I'm new on the board, and one of the things that has been bothering me ever since I've come on the board is how much it's costing us in early voting for such poor turnout. And the problem is both the cost that we're required to do based on what the county based on what the state says we have to keep in staffing, and the fact that we're using four sites around the county, and the fact that the turnout is so low. Some of it is as much, in some of the locations, as much as $60 a vote. And I'm still concerned about that. I agree with Mr. Cole. We really do have an obligation to our voters to make voting accessible, and we can't do that. And we can do that because we have voting day that's available almost in everyone's backyard. So I'm really concerned at two areas. One is the fact that we are spending taxpayer money. We have a responsibility to the taxpayer not to spend the money frugally or unfrugal, and I have a problem with that. But by the same token, we are branching into something we haven't done except in the municipal elections. We have had one stop in one place at the municipal elections, and it worked fine, but the turnout was very low. But they had to drive all the way to Wentworth in order to vote from all over the county. And they did turn out, but most of them went to their typical polling place. So the concern I have is, how do we balance between accessibility, which we say is important, and, you know, not overspending, not, you know, we could take this to the extreme and say that we're going to send somebody to vote at everybody's house
obviously that's going to be a tremendous cost. So, you know, I think we need to look at the extremes. But the real problem I have is that we're venturing into a territory where we don't know whether we can handle the volume. I looked at the biggest election that we've had in this county in my lifetime, and that was the 2020 election, and we did have almost 6,000 early voters to turn out. So the question is, really, and I know you don't have the answer, but the question is, how can we balance between getting people to vote at the regular time or early voting and the cost involved with early voting?
Sure. I saw the figures that Ms. Seamster had shown me about the voting here versus the other sites, and they are quite compelling.
Mm-hmm. How do we move forward, board members?
Oh, have we finished asking any questions?
I think so.
We thank you.
Yes. We thank you for coming in and explaining to us or in answering the questions that we have for you, and your colleagues.
And again, I can work with Ms. Seamster on working on the budget if you need me to.
On working on the budget. Explain what you mean.
Budget modifications, as I mentioned earlier.
All right. I'm waiting.
Madam Chair, I'd like to be recognized for a motion.
Yes, sir.
I move that the board proceed to establish a plan for the four precincts that we have utilized or voting places in the past, and we move forward with that. And in accordance with Mr. Metzler's comments, move forward with the budgeting for that, since we have no other way of funding this election. I, having been in the legislature, I understand that they make these movements at odd times when it comes to budgeting for it. And that's where we are today. They changed the number of days, the number of hours, and the consequences are it takes us out of the budget we had in the past. So in the future, I think we should move forward with trying to, for lack of a better word, educate our public to where they can vote sooner. There's a lot of things we could be doing to cause people to want to vote. And I think if we deny anyone the right to vote anywhere as a result of age or inability to transport themselves, then we are held responsible for that. So I move that we vote in favor of my motion.
Madam Chairman, may I speak?
Yes.
I agree with Nelson. You know, we've had confirmation from Mr. Metzler that the funds will be available if we have a shortfall, and I think we need to do what's best for the county. So I second the motion that we move forward with the one-stop voting sites that we have had in the past.
Madam Chairman, I hate to be the stick in the mud here, but okay. We approved a plan in the January 25 meeting. Before we can move forward with anything else, we need to rescind or change that plan, and then we can proceed with the new motion.
Okay. So the two individuals that made the motion and second the first plan.
Well, I would move to table their motion for the time being until we fix the January 25.
Okay, so we need a motion to table the first motion, and we need a second. So moved by member.
Madam Chairman. I'm sorry,
and we need a second.
So the motion is that we should table the motion that was just made, correct?
No.
Is that correct, Thurman?
Yes.
I concur.
And then we go back.
I move to, excuse me, Madam Chairman, I move to rescind the vote from the January 25 meeting to approve only one voting site.
Is that your motion?
That's my motion.
Second?
Okay, it has been moved and properly second that we rescind the motion in January for the one-stop.
You rescind the vote itself, not the
motion. The vote itself.
Madam Chairman, may I speak? I just want the public to understand that that motion was made because at that time, we didn't have the funds to operate other voting sites other than the one in Wentworth. So that they're clear on why we voted for that in January, just to have the one stop at Wentworth only.
We're operating under a different set of
rights.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All not in favor have the same right.
No.
Okay, now we need a new motion.
Make your motion again. It was Nelson's motion.
Madam Chair, I move that we proceed with the establishing of four remote sites for voting in accordance with the plan that we had previously discussed.
I second that motion.
All right. It has been moved and properly second that we proceed with the plan as we had previously done with the four sites open. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposers have the same right, say nay. You have approved four sites to be open. According to the information that we have received from our county manager, please make sure that it's duly noted in our minutes.
Chair, you didn't offer an opportunity for discussion of that motion.
Well, we did a lot of discussion before. It was really dead on the floor.
We really did a lot of discussion of the legal procedures, and I'm not sure, since we approved the minutes earlier, I suppose we can go back and rescind that, and that's what we just did. But I have some concerns in that we're saying that we're going to do this based on, I suppose, Mr. Metzler, information for us. We still don't have the money.
We don't.
So what's that going to do to us?
If we don't get the money.
If we don't get it. And if that's a problem, that will be a problem, I would see, that we could affect the fact that we've got a state requirement for right now for an election in May the 17th. And that is not far away, and there's a lot of work we got to do. And so the question that I have is that if we have that, if we don't have that as a firm commitment, we do have it from the county manager. But I think we need to go ahead and present that very quickly to them for their review on their meeting on the 21st to get approval, because I don't want us to spend a lot of time doing planning and getting people lined up and then turn around and have to delay things.
I understand.
Your position is, what you are trying to get us to understand is that we have to spend the money first.
So what I would recommend, Madam Chairman, is that you all approve, how do we say this? You all approve the moving of the $41,000 within your budget contingent upon myself and Ms. Seamster working on an adequate budget to present to the commissioners. Would that be the best route to go? Because you guys, I don't want you guys to have to schedule another meeting just to approve what we come up with $28,700 she's already identified, and I can help her with the rest of it. So you guys would have to approve that contingent upon us developing an adequate budget to present to our commissioners.
Does that make sense? Okay, but to get to Tom's point,
you'll have to spend the money first.
We spend the money.
Yes, sir.
Spending the money, actually spending the money or having it budgeted change? In other words, if we were to change our budget to reflect what you're saying that you think's available and that Paula thinks available, because that figure was only roughly $20,000.
And I can identify the rest of the $12,000. That I think that could cover the expenses. And again, if you run out or close to it at the end of the fiscal year, hopefully Paula will let me know in advance, and we'll work with the commissioners on that.
With that.
Any more unreadiness from anyone? And we've already made a decision, but I mean, we're just having some discussion.
Chair, I think we need to introduce a motion to have the director and the county manager and his team meet to identify the funds from our budget so that it can be transferred. Is that the?
That's correct. And you would have to approve what we come up with contingent upon what we agree on. That way you won't have to set a special meeting to approve a 5-minute meeting to approve just what we come up with.
Okay. I would second that motion.
Okay. Do we have any discussion before we get ready to vote? Because I don't want us to come back and say it and give you a chance to have a discussion on it. So it has been moved and properly seconded that we follow the steps that we need to make for the county commissioners to look at, for the county manager to work with Paula for the $41,000 within our budget, board members, against my recommendation. But so all in favor? Say aye.
Aye.
Oppose this? Have the same sign, say aye. So you have decided to allow Paula to get together with our county manager and his the members that he brought in here with him to bring back to us or to make an agreement on the funds that we need to have within our budget to open up the 4 sites. Okay? Ready to move? All right. So now we're moving to number 8, MOU between the board. Thank you again for coming in. MOU between the Board of Elections of Rockingham County and the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners. So Paula is going to talk to us about that.
Okay, in your packet is a copy of the Memorandum of Understanding between the Board of Elections of Rockingham County and the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners. What this MOU is for is so that the Board of Elections will be able to use the county's personnel policy as our own. And what that would include is we would be able to follow the human resources policies. We would be able to use the human resources office to help with our hiring and other procedures that are needed within our office. And there were some concerns that I had read, but I have had those concerns answered, and I am confident with what this document says, and I am seeking approval from the Board of Elections. And if there is approval from the Board of Elections, it would go before the Board of Commissioners for their final approval.
Board members, do you have any questions for Paula concerning the MOU that she has presented?
Madam Chair, I have one question.
Okay.
We had given a copy of this to the county attorney. Did we get feedback from the county attorney as to any recommended changes or any concerns?
No, sir.
Reviewed that with Letts.
He has received it as well.
On that last page, adopted this blank day of, should be 2022, right? And make sure we change that. Is there any other discussion before we approve the MOU? Are we still looking at it?
Madam Chair, just a follow-up question to what our other board member, Mr. Schofield, responded to. I'm assuming that you feel pretty confident we're okay with the county.
I think so. I mean,
okay, well.
And I did ask, I know at the last meeting, the question was asked if there were other any other MOUs within the county. The only other MOU with any other department is with the Cooperative Extension. So there were none with the Sheriff's Office, the Airport Authority, or anything like that. And I had sent that email to you.
Madam Chair, based on the comments, I call a question.
All right. It has been motioned, and we need a second.
I second that motion.
All right. You were giving me a motion when you called a question, right?
I was calling a question. I thought we already had a motion. We didn't have a motion? Okay. Yeah. I'll make the motion, and we proceed with the MOU.
All right.
With the county.
It has been moved and properly seconded that we should proceed with the MOU. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposers have the same right. They can say aye as well. You have approved the MOU, and Paula will take it through the next steps. All right, at number nine, Director's Update, 2022 Primary Election Update.
Okay, the primary election right now is still scheduled for May the 17th. The redistricting maps are due to State Board this Friday, the 18th, by noon. The parties will have the opportunity to appeal those maps until 5 o'clock p.m. Once those maps are received and it's moving forward, if there are no appeals, the State Board will start working on those maps, working on the shake files, and getting those to the counties. If there is an appeal, I don't know what the next step will be. I don't know if the election will still be May 17th, if it'll be postponed. We do not know. We'll just have to see what happens Friday at 5 o'clock p.m. If everything moves forward, candidate filing will begin next Thursday, the 24th at 8 a.m. and run through 12 o'clock p.m. on Friday, March the 4th. So, and for, it's my understanding we may not get the shake files until the 23rd. So we will be asking, as most likely when the candidates come in the file, we'll have to check their residence to make sure that they are still within the district maps. But it'll be a lot of work on the Board of Elections, but we will get it done. And then, like, we have the early voting schedule already established if everything is on board for the May 17th election. Are there any questions? Okay. So we're moving on to the 2022 Spring State Board of Elections Virtual Conference, which will be held Monday, March the 14th, 2022, and Tuesday, March the 15th, 2022. That will be at the Board of Elections office. And with that being our regular, well, the Tuesday being our regular meeting date, we have it as item C, the Board of Elections meeting date change for March the 15th. And I would like to ask the board if they would like to change that and delay it 1 week. I have sent a request to the clerk, to the board, to see if this meeting room would be available on March the 22nd at 10 o'clock. And I've also asked Roy with, Roy Sawyers, who videos our meetings, and he has also penciled that in on his calendar that he would be available. But that would be up to this board if you want to delay our meeting schedule for March 1 week, or if you have any other ideas.
Board members?
Madam Chairman, I make a motion that we change our March meeting date to March the 22nd.
Second.
Any discussion? It has been moved and properly seconded that we change our March 15, 2022 general meeting to March 27, 2022, at 10 o'clock in this building. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those not in favor, say aye. You have approved to move our March 15th, 2022 meeting to March 22nd, 2022 at 10 o'clock.
Item is the fiscal year 2022-2023 Board of Elections budget. We've already held our first budget work session last Wednesday, and I have found out a lot of the answers that the board has requested, gotten more numbers, and it's being updated this week. I'm only waiting on one more call, and I will have all those numbers. But I would like to know if this board would like to meet next Tuesday, February 22nd at 10 o'clock to go over the budget again. We do have a deadline of March the 11th to make the submissions of our budget to the county.
Have you already made the necessary arrangements for? Oh, we will have that at the.
We'll have that at our office.
All right. Any discussion, board members? To continue our Board of Elections budget on February 22nd, 10 o'clock, at the Board of Elections.
Do we have to have a motion, or can we agree by consensus to meet on the 22nd?
We can.
It's a call meeting, so I think if two of us agree.
Right.
So we will meet February 22nd at the Board of Elections office at 10 o'clock to continue our Board of Elections budget.
And that's all I have.
All right. So I'd like to entertain board members, if there's nothing else, no other additional comments or anything, I'd like to entertain a motion to adjourn.
I so move.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we adjourn. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those not in favor, say aye. You have approved to adjourn at
1054. Yep.
Thank you.
The hands on top of each other, that's what makes the difference.
I'm trying to see it. Okay. Thank you for coming, everyone.
Thank you.